Okay, the final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 2093 in the name of Jenny Minto on the importance of community defibrillators. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Would those members who wish to contribute to the debate please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. Place an R in the chat function. And I call on Jenny Minto to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Ms. Minto.
Okay. Thank you, Presiding Officer. My dear friend Carl Reavy died of an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest in January 2018. He was 61. Carl was a force of nature, and his sudden, shocking death impacted on the many people who had the great fortune to know him. This debate is in Carl's memory and in those of all who have lost loved ones as a result of cardiac arrest, but also as a recognition of communities across Scotland, including within my own constituency of Argyll and Bute, who have raised funds, completed training and helped save lives through the installation of defibrillators. I would like to thank all the members from across the chamber who have supported this motion. We are in the privileged position of being able to help raise the awareness of the work that the British Heart Foundation is doing alongside the Scottish Ambulance Service, NHS Scotland and Microsoft in establishing the Circuit, Scotland's first network of defibrillators. I never met my maternal grandfather. He died of an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest in 1964. Back then, there was only a vague understanding of the processes underlying heart disease. Doctors couldn't do much but simply let nature take its course. Since then, the Scottish death rate from heart and circulatory diseases has declined by more than three quarters. But for out-of-hospital cardiac arrests, and there are about 3,200 in Scotland every year, the survival rate is only 10%. Starkly, every minute without CPR and defibrillation reduces the chance of survival by 10%. The Scottish Government out-of-hospital cardiac arrest strategy aims for 20% of cardiac arrests to have a defibrillator applied before the ambulance arrives. And with research suggesting this means a defibrillator every 200 metres in urban areas and one for every 1,000 people in rural areas, this is quite a target to reach. Cairndhu, around the head of Loch Fyne in Argyll and Bute, has three community defibrillators, two community funded and one by a local business. Last year, one was deployed when a visitor fell ill in a remote part of the community. The response was exceptional. The British Heart Foundation had provided two basic life support training sessions in the Cairndhu Village Hall. The first person on the scene had attended this training and commenced manual CPR, whilst directing someone else to get to the nearest defibrillator and raise the alarm. The air ambulance, an ambulance crew and police all attended. The community defibrillator was applied before the services arrived. This was a community response made possible by British Heart Foundation training, locally funded defibrillators and good community awareness. The next day, the defibrillator pads were replaced by private community donations to keep the defibrillator in service. Without individuals donating or communities fundraising, the defibrillators will not be there, and so the Scottish Government's target may be difficult to achieve. My motion notes that more could be done. Here are two suggestions. I'm sure there are a lot more. By using building planning, could new developments be mandated to put in a defibrillator cabinet? And then, following on from my question at last week's budget, could the Scottish Government campaign for a VAT removal or a reduction on defibrillators? I started by remembering Carl Reavy. Carl's life was action-packed. He was a sound engineer with the Undertones, a bird watcher, a photographer, an editor, a hotelier, a promoter of whisky, a cyclist. He was a son, a brother, a husband, a father, a friend. Carl's smile lit up and laughter lit up the room, but an electrical malfunction in his heart forced life from him. Jan, his wife, was alone with him when it happened. She dialed 999. She administered CPR, being told not to stop until the ambulance arrived. She couldn't leave him. no one knew to get the village defibrillator. Registering your community defibrillator on the circuit might help in circumstances like this. So please, please do it. Presiding Officer, I will finish with the words on the memorial for Carl in the community woodland that he and I worked together to establish. A lover of nature, by nature good-natured, by nature a friend, a lover of a dram, naturally, by nature a thinker, by nature a doer, a force of nature. I simply ask on behalf of Jan that we lose no more forces of nature simply because a defibrillator is not registered on the circuit. Thank you.
Well done, thank you, Ms Minto. I now call on Christine Graham, who will be followed by Liz Smith. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I have quite a short contribution, but it is important that I advise the Chamber of the activities and influence of Scottish Heart in campaigning to increase the distribution of defibrillators. Scottish Heart, which stands for Heart at Risk Testing, was founded in 1997 by Kenneth and Wilma Gunn, for some time my Selkirk constituents. I note it's not listed in the various organisations, but it's an important little organisation. Tragically, and just as the stories of you've recalled, on May 27, 1991, their son, Cameron, collapsed and died during a five-a-side football match. Even more cruelly, it was the night before his 20th birthday. He suffered from hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, though nobody knew about that till after his death. Regrettably, other young people, often active sportsmen and women, have also died in a similar tragic fashion. From 1997 onwards, Wilma Gunn and Kenny, her husband, fundraised, raised the profile, even in here, campaigned for not only early testing of young athletes, but accessible defibrillators. Again, not many knew what a defibrillator, including myself, was. In Parliament here, the profile was raised with debates and with petitions in the early years of this Parliament. And in 2014, deservedly, Wilma was awarded an MBE. Today, we have defibrillators in many points: train, bus stations, airports, supermarkets, here and in some workplaces. But Kenny and Wilma Gunn haven't stopped campaigning and are keen to see those even more distributed. They are easy to use. The new ones are easy to use. You cannot hurt the patient. In fact, better to use it and let them die in front of you. You can't do any more harm than doing nothing. I have practiced here and elsewhere on them, and if I can use them, because I'm hopeless, anyone else certainly can. Those invaluable minutes on the defibrillator will mean life or death until the medics arrive. And this is especially relevant in rural areas, such as my constituency, where paramedics can't simply be there within 8 minutes. And so I wanted to come into this debate to remind the Chamber of other less well-known people who've campaigned through tragic circumstances to try and bring this issue, which saves so many lives, to the forefront. And I congratulate Wilma and Kenny Gunn, who all these years later are still campaigning for Scottish Heart and defibrillators. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Graham. I now call on Liz Smith to be followed by Stuart McMillan. Again, 4 minutes, Ms Smith.
Thank you. And could I warmly congratulate Jenny Minto for bringing this vitally important issue and for the tone that she has set. I thought she made a very moving speech, and it's something that I think we all have to play our own part in. I'm somebody who actually witnessed the life-saving capacity of rural defibrillators when one member of my constituency staff suffered a cardiac arrest when located in a rural part of Perthshire. And I've no doubt whatsoever that if the village had not had a defibrillator to hand, this colleague would not have survived. And of course, the office that Murdoch Fraser and myself share is part of the building for the air ambulance, and I know just how much they appreciate all the work that is done. Deputy Presiding Officer, now more than ever, we are so aware of what our healthcare services do for us and indeed just how precious are the principles of the NHS that it meets the needs of everyone based on clinical need. And we're also so aware of the work that the exceptional NHS staff undertake, but I think we have to include the work of all those who look after our rapid response ambulance teams, all those who are involved in campaigning for defibrillators, and I think it's important to compliment the members of our local communities, just as Christine Graham has done, who are so much part of this very important campaign. Over 3,000 people every year suffer an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, but if you're one of these 3,000 living in a rural area, you are 32% less likely to survive than others. So people from more deprived areas are 60% less likely to survive, to be discharged, and most from more less deprived areas. And the responsibility, of course, is for us all to ensure that no matter where people are, we are able to respond to any out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. So it's very good to hear that over the past 5 years, the Save a Life for Scotland partnership has equipped over 640,000 people with the skills necessary to resuscitate. Continuing to train people on how to react is vital, but we also need defibrillator equipment readily available and, just as importantly, properly maintained. And as both Christine Graham and Jenny Minto have flagged up, the information about where they actually are located is so crucial. So I wholeheartedly support the provision of more defibrillators and was delighted to hear that the Rattray community has become the latest in the Perth and Kinross area to install a new defibrillator just in November there. There are, however, challenges to ensure that the yearly monitoring, which is so important, actually happens, that the part replacement costs can be met, that the location of the devices can be made more consistent, and that we can support our local communities. We know in Wales that the government has pledged £3 million to improve public access to defibrillators, and as Jenny Minto rightly pointed out, I think there's a little more what you can do in Scotland to ensure that we have further outreach. Presiding Officer, in 2015, only around 1 in 20 survived an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. Thankfully, that statistic is a little better. It's now 1 in 10, but the survival rate is, of course, still too low. So I welcome the progress that we have made, the increased chance of survival, and the continued installations of defibrillator equipment across Scotland in its entirety. But we still have a long way to go to ensuring that people's lives are fully protected. And for me, that's not just about the clinical assistance that we need to provide. It's about ourselves taking responsibility and ensuring that our local communities are very well prepared and know exactly what to do. And I think we have all a part to play as MSPs in helping that process. So I warmly thank Jenny Minto again for this debate, and I'll do my part to ensure that we're giving that support.
Thank you very much, Ms Smith. I now call on Stuart McMillan, who will be followed by Carol Mochan. Again, 4 minutes, Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, I want to congratulate Jenny Minto for securing this important debate. I agree wholeheartedly with her motion, as public access to defibrillators have become one of the biggest constituency matters that I have ever dealt with. In 2017, I met a local woman, Kathleen Orr, whose son Jaden tragically died following a cardiac arrest. And during Kathleen's evidence to the Public Petitions Committee in 2018, she said, and I quote, "Jaden went skating in the morning, as usual, and to his normal skate club in the evening. While he was doing his normal skate routine, he collapsed on the ice and never got back up again. That was when my world fell apart. I do not remember too much after that, but I know that there were a lot of members of staff, and not one of them knew what the others were doing. To my knowledge, there was a defibrillator, but none of the staff used it because they were not fully trained and were scared of doing so." Kathleen was given evidence after lodging her petition to make it a legal requirement to have a public access defibrillator placed on all new buildings over a certain size, which is option one that Jenny Minto put forward earlier. Presiding Officer, I have gotten to know Kathleen on her mission to increase the number of defibrillators across Inverclyde. And when she started her charity in memory of Jaden, affectionately called Jaden's Rainbow, there were only 4 automated external defibrillators, or AEDs, in Inverclyde. Today, there are 41, including 2 at Ferguson Marine in Port Glasgow, 1 on each of the 2 ships being built. If it were not for COVID, there would be more across the constituency. Following discussions with Kathleen, I brought local and national stakeholders together to help increase AED provision across Inverclyde and also Scotland. And St Andrews First Aid were so impressed with Kathleen's work that they gifted her 30 of their old AEDs that were then reconditioned. She is placing these across Inverclyde, in addition to those that she has already fundraised and given to local schools and purchased through her campaigning and fundraising efforts. Kathleen, her daughter Kerry and son Declan all now volunteer with St Andrews First Aid. As well as improving access to the AEDs, they want to show everyone that we should not be afraid of AEDs. In fact, they are foolproof. They will not work unless someone has a shockable heart rhythm. According to St Andrews First Aid, those from the most deprived areas are 43% less likely to survive a cardiac arrest. And given Inverclyde's challenges with deprivation, Kathleen's efforts become all the more significant when we acknowledge this statistic. In the last few years, there has been a real awakening to the need to increase access to AEDs, but also the importance of having a record of where they all are. And that's why the work of the British Heart Foundation in partnership with the Scottish Ambulance Service, the NHS and Microsoft in establishing the circuit, Scotland's first network of defibrillators, is so vital. The British Heart Foundation provided a very helpful briefing for this debate, and I want to highlight just three key points. First of all, performing CPR can more than double the chances of survival in some cases. But secondly, every minute without CPR and defibrillation reduces the chance of survival by up to 10%. And the third point, tens of thousands of defibrillators are currently not known by ambulance services. Knowing the defibrillator's location can be the difference between life and death. I want to conclude on that point. Owning a defib is great, but if nobody knows where it is in an emergency, you can actually have that life-saving machine lying dormant. So anyone who's watching this, anyone who's going to read the official report after this debate, please register your AED with the circuit. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr McMillan. I now call Carol Mochen, who joins us remotely, who will be followed by Jackie Dunbar. In 4 minutes, Ms Mochen.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I also thank Jenny Minto for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. It was a lovely contribution from her. In my view, this debate allows us to consider and connect two important elements, the life-saving technologies we are so lucky to have available to us, and the community who bring it to our doors to ensure that, whenever possible, lives can be saved. We've heard a bit about what a cardiac arrest from members before me. To be clear, sudden cardiac arrest occurs suddenly and often without warning. Sudden cardiac arrest is the abrupt loss of heart function, breathing and consciousness. And I also think we do need to understand and remind ourselves, as other has, that death occurs within minutes if the victim does not receive treatment. And therefore, it is so important we raise the understanding and awareness of this condition. Debating tonight here in the Scottish Parliament, quite rightly, can be a step towards raising that awareness. But as the Chamber knows, Deputy Presiding Officer, we must go further in our campaigns after this debate. Figures that we've heard reveal that every year over 3,000 people in Scotland experience an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. The British Heart Foundation's figures show that only 1 in 10 victims survive. However, crucially, the chance of surviving a cardiac arrest jumps from 6% to 74% if the casualty is in a shockable rhythm and a defibrillator is deployed within 3 minutes. This statistic shows so clearly why it is important, as the motion states, to have accessible community defibrillators well maintained and easily available to every community. We are to reduce deaths from out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. It is important, as people have said, that people know how to use the defibrillators. It's important that we train people to use them, and it's important people feel confident to use them. Understanding that, with quick, decisive action, we can save a life, this gives us all great purpose to do more. Access to defibrillators is vital to saving lives. And at this point, I would like to say to Jenny Minto that I would happily support any of the campaigns that she puts forward from this debate. And this is where I also want to pay tribute to the communities who fundraise and maintain these defibrillators, these life-saving pieces of equipment. In my own community of Mauchline, a well-thought-out strategy following some fantastic fundraising has resulted in a community defibrillator based at the centre of the village, with another due to be installed in another part of the village. The community association based at Centre Stane has implemented a plan which includes good maintenance, as well as ensuring there is a high level of local understanding in terms of how to access and use the equipment, as well as registering it with the circuit. These measures, as we have heard from other members in the debate, in any community are to be commended, and I am so proud of the efforts in my own village. Before finishing, I want to raise awareness of the circuit. As I mentioned, my local defibrillator is registered with the circuit. The National Defibrillator Network, which provides a national overview of where defibrillators can be found, connects to the NHS Ambulance Service across the UK. So in those crucial moments after a cardiac arrest, they can be accessed quickly to help save lives. At the moment, as we have heard, many defibrillators never get used because emergency services don't know where they are. This can cost lives, and this is why this is so important that this infrastructure is available. Before I conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, I would like to take time to reaffirm a key point I have made in previous debates in this chamber. Inequalities in health and healthcare cannot be ignored, and as mentioned in this debate, it is no different in this instance. People from more deprived areas in Scotland are almost twice as likely to have an out-of-hour cardiac arrest and are 60% less likely to survive to leave hospital than those from less deprived areas. We must not forget these factors when planning for the future. I believe it's crucial that the government address issues of inequality as a matter of urgency before it is too late for more people. Key to this is tackling the root causes of health inequality. Deputy Presiding Officer, once again, can I recognise the importance of this motion and commend the work of those volunteers and organisations who are raising awareness of this issue, and thank all the members for contributing to this important debate this evening. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. I now call Jackie Dunbar, who will be followed by Gillian Mackay. 4 minutes, please, Ms Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank and congratulate Jenny Minto for bringing this motion forward for members' business tonight and for her very personal and very powerful speech. I know just how close the subject is to Jenny, as I first met her at a British Heart Foundation roundtable event during the election campaign. And I saw that day someone who was as passionate as I was in ensuring that we do all we can to ensure access to defibrillators. At the end of the day, defibrillators can be the difference between life and death for someone who suffers cardiac arrest, and it highlights the important role they play in our communities. On that point, it is so important that they are widely available, accessible, and that folk know how to use them to save someone's life. Presiding Officer, defibrillators are used to administrate an electric shock to a person who is having a cardiac arrest and are designed for use by your average person to allow someone with no medical training to save a life. They can and should be available in public places for use by the public when they're required. These defibrillators are designed to be used by members of the public who have not received any training, but we need people to be confident and not scared of potentially using one in a life or death scenario. So the devices provide audible instructions and sometimes visual prompts on a screen to help people through the process, making them easy and safer to use. It is so important that people know what to expect when using a defibrillator, and my understanding is that when a person puts the pads on a chest, it will analyse the heart's electrical rhythm, and if it detects an abnormal rhythm, which is likely to respond to a shock, it will charge itself. And that, for me, is a huge... It takes away a huge responsibility on the person that's going to use it, I think. And some devices then deliver the shock automatically without needing any further action by the operator. Others instruct the operator to press a button to deliver the shock before instructing the operator to carry out CPR for a period. It may require more than one shock to save someone's life, but the machine will talk you through every step of the way, so please do not be scared to use one. One of the key things for people to know is that it won't allow a shock to be given unless it's needed, meaning it is extremely unlikely that it will do any harm to the person who has collapsed. Presiding Officer, I was extremely pleased that Aberdeen City Council recently agreed to have officers look at the feasibility of providing defibrillators in all schools and sheltered accommodation buildings, and this received cross-party support, something which is probably very rare nowadays in the chamber of Aberdeen City Council. So it was just brilliant to see that across the chamber we came together to agree that. As I've said repeatedly, it's so important that defibrillators are in accessible locations and they are known about in the communities that they're in. A key point to the success of them is knowing where to find one and then being accessible and close to where they're actually needed. Unfortunately, I couldn't find a central bank of locations where people can log on to find their nearest one. A quick internet search puts my nearest one at my home at Northfield Community Centre, but I know there are ones closer, and I encourage all those with defibrillators to register this on the circuit website to ensure everyone can quickly find the nearest one in an emergency. Presiding Officer, I'd just like to thank Jenny Minto once again for bringing this important thing forward today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Dunbar. I now call Gillian Mackay, who will be followed by Marie McNair. 4 minutes, please, Ms McNair.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be speaking in today's debate, and I want to thank Jenny Minto too for bringing this very important debate to the Chamber. Her powerful speech really has set the tone for this important debate. I'd also like to thank the British Heart Foundation for the briefing that they've sent us all. Since the 1960s, we've seen huge strides forward in heart attack survival. In the 1960s, more than 7 out of 10 heart attacks were fatal. Today, at least 7 out of 10 survive. There are currently 10,000 hospital admissions for heart attacks each year, on average, one every 50 minutes. We need to do more work on making people aware of their heart health risks and the implication this has for their long-term health. We know of the links between poor diet, lack of exercise, smoking and inequality and poor health. Inequality as a driver of poor health cannot be underplayed, and the prevalence of heart disease in areas of higher inequality points to the work that still needs to be done. And as Stuart McMillan pointed out, you're also less likely to have access to a defibrillator in areas of high inequality. Let me stress that it is never too late to look after your heart health. I know the new year would often give rise to an attempt to establish new healthy habits, but I would encourage everyone to seriously look at your heart health and the small but important lifestyle changes you could make to improve it. Preventative care is a huge part of cutting down the number of heart attacks and potential cardiac arrests, but when they do happen and when these instances are not in hospital, CPR and community defibrillators are life-saving on a number of occasions, especially in rural cases, as was noted by Christine Graham and Liz Smith. I think it shows how these issues touch such a large number of people. Learning CPR could be one of the best things everyone at home could do over the Christmas holidays. You never know when you may need it. For someone who has a cardiac arrest, their likelihood of survival decreases by up to 10% every minute without intervention. Defibrillators may appear daunting and the word is difficult to say, but importantly, you do not need training to use one. They give clear spoken instructions and you cannot accidentally shock anyone. The machine will only shock when it detects the target rhythm. Currently, less than 5% of out-of-hospital cardiac arrests receive bystander intervention. Yet I'm sure across this chamber we've read stories in the press of the incredible people who do step in and make that difference. And I cannot stress this enough. Knowing what to do could save a life. Many communities across the country, including many in my Central Scotland region, have fundraised to put defibrillators in key places. Unfortunately, many of these are not registered with the circuit. The circuit provides a national overview of where defibrillators can be found. The circuit connects defibrillators to NHS ambulance services so that in those crucial moments after a cardiac arrest, they can be accessed quickly to help save lives. The circuit also does life-saving work with regular reminders about maintenance. If communities know of a defibrillator that is not on the circuit, get in touch with the network and get it registered. Knowing where it is might just help save someone. And can I just once again congratulate Jenny Minto on this debate? Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. McKay. And I call Marie McNair, to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. 4 minutes, please, Ms. McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before I start, can I bring members' attention to my register of interest as a serving member of West Dunbartonshire Council? Can I begin my contribution by congratulating Jenny Minto for securing this members' debate? And I know this issue is very close to Jenny Minto's heart. It is important that we take this opportunity to raise awareness of the need to have more accessible defibrillators in our communities. The British Heart Foundation point out that less than 1 in 10 people survive an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, and they call on us to act to reduce 2 of the reasons for this tragic statistic. There aren't enough people who feel prepared and confident to perform CPR, and there aren't enough defibrillators. I have a strong interest in promoting the accessibility of this life-saving equipment in my role as a councillor on West Dunbartonshire Council, but also on a personal level, having lost my own father at 52 to a cardiac arrest. Had these defibrillators been more readily available, it might have been a more positive outcome. In 2017, I was delighted to launch a campaign to help compile a list of defibrillators available in public buildings, businesses, organisations and in ownership of groups across West Dunbartonshire. I was able to follow this up by securing £50,000 from the Council and £25,000 from the West Dunbartonshire Health and Social Care Partnership. This funding has been used to secure there is a good geographical spread of automatic external defibrillators throughout the local authority. I thank my colleagues on West Dunbartonshire Council for the cross-party support on this important issue, and there are things that can unite us, and the gains from this important work are there for all to see. In fact, in recent weeks, I chaired a meeting of the Council's Defibrillator Working Group, where we managed to secure another defibrillator for the Linvale Community Group in Clydebank. We will assist the group in getting this installed in a prominent position within the area. We have real experience on our working group, and it's their continuing efforts that are helping to save lives. On the working group, we have Sheena Nelson, Heartstart Coordinator of Helensburgh and Local Districts, CPR Defibrillator Association, Dr Jan Cresham, who represents the Trossachs Search and Rescue Service, and have developed the app, and also Anne Harris from Scottish Ambulance Service. But also in that group, we have Brian Martin, who is now a retired paramedic. And Brian collapsed while playing football at Scotstoun Leisure Centre and owes his life to his colleagues from the Ambulance Service. Following successful fundraising events by Brian and his colleagues, a defibrillator had been installed in the centre just a matter of weeks prior to Brian's collapse. That very defibrillator was used to save Brian's life. My thanks also go to my constituent, Norma Docherty, who lost her son to sudden arrhythmic death syndrome in 2011. Norma fundraised in her son's memory to install defibrillators in his former primary and high school. Overall, there's now 220 publicly accessible defibrillators across the area between Clydebank and the Gairloch side. Each defibrillator has a dedicated community guardian who looks after it and checks that it is in good working order. In addition, I commend the excellent work of the Mogai Community First Responders. They're a volunteer group within the Mogai and Bearsden area who respond to specific 999 calls prior to the arrival of an ambulance. With over 600 call-outs to date, they're a lifeline service for our community in the drive to save lives. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we all know about the serious levels of heart disease, and we all know that access to these machines can increase survival rates. To date, in West Dunbartonshire, 28 lives have been saved through publicly accessible defibrillators being installed throughout our communities, and 11 of them have been used during the lockdown. Our work has shown how important it is to take ownership of this issue. We know it saves lives. I also take this opportunity to congratulate Heartstart Helensburgh and Local Districts for winning the Volunteer of the Year Award at the Scottish Health Awards Ceremony recently held in Edinburgh. Heartstart continue to deliver emergency life support and defibrillator awareness training. And I'm really proud of all the volunteers in my community who continue to work so hard and dedicate their time to this cause. It's been an honour and a privilege to share their experiences on their behalf in this Parliament. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. Now call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Rona Mackay. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I would just like to remind members of my register of interest that shows I'm still a serving councillor at Aberdeen City Council. First, I'd like to thank Jenny Minto for bringing this debate to Parliament tonight, and I really enjoyed your very powerful contribution. Like other members, I commend the work of community organisations and fundraising to purchase defibrillators. Likewise, the work of the British Heart Foundation and others. The work has increased the number of defibrillators across Scotland. However, we must do all we can to provide more support to ensure that this network of life-saving equipment is properly registered, checked and maintained. After all, this really is a matter of life or death, and that is the reason I feel compelled to take part in this debate tonight. Earlier this year, a constituent of mine was in desperate need of a defibrillator. His son rushed to the defibrillator that they had in their local village, but for whatever reason, it was not on the 999 or circuit system. He tried desperately to get it open, but without the code to unlock it, there was nothing he could do. He was tantalisingly close, and I cannot think of a crueler situation than that. And very tragically, my constituent passed away. He paid the ultimate price, losing his life, and his family are left with the tortuous, traumatic thoughts of what if for the rest of their life. It's unacceptable that we only find out defibrillators are not properly connected or maintained at the point when someone is calling 999 with a desperate medical need for it. You know, at the moment, local authorities regularly check life rings to make sure they're fit for purpose. And I would like to see Scottish Government provide funding to local authorities or to community groups to allow them to carry out similar checks on a regular basis. Because like a life ring, defibrillators are hopefully never needed. But in an emergency situation, we need to know that the kit is available and works. At that point, it's too late if it's vandalised or broken or suffering from some other kind of fault. And like Jackie Dunbar, I welcome the fact that Aberdeen City Council are investigating the possibility of installing defibrillators at all schools and sheltered housing locations. And as she said, it is a rare moment when all parties at Aberdeen agree, but we certainly did at that time. And as has been mentioned already, too many people are have undiagnosed heart conditions that cause out-of-hospital heart attacks. And currently, as Jenny Minto said, only 1 in 10 people who suffer an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest survive. And we must do more to prevent this, and we can. The work that small community groups have done to help fund defibrillators up and down our country deserves tremendous praise. But this is a huge problem, and it needs the attention and resource of government, bringing in recommendations from charities such as Heart Valve Voice and other heart disease specialists. At present, too many lives are lost prematurely to heart disease in Scotland, and I hope there are steps that this government and everyone else can take to help tackle that. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Lumsden. And I now call the final speaker in the open debate, Rona Mackay, who joins us remotely. 4 minutes, please, Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank my colleague, Jenny Minto, for bringing this important debate to the Chamber and for her moving opening speech. Presiding Officer, as we've heard from the excellent speeches across the Chamber tonight, defibrillators save lives. That is clear. We know that if a defibrillator is required within 3 minutes of a cardiac arrest for it to be effective, and that their availability is becoming widespread across the communities of Scotland. However, we also know that people living in the least affluent areas of the country are 60% less likely to survive an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest because defibrillators are not so available there. So more needs to be done to address that quickly. That's why the importance of the work of the British Heart Foundation in partnership with the Scottish Ambulance Service, the NHS and Microsoft in establishing the circuit, which, as we've heard tonight, is a map of Scotland's first network of defibrillators, and their importance just can't be overstated. We must raise awareness and education on defibrillator use, including the registration of all defibrillators on the circuit, to help the Scottish Ambulance Service know where they are in the event of an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, because we know that early defibrillation can more than double a person's chances of survival from a cardiac arrest, but that many defibrillators are never used because presently emergency servers don't know where they're located.
Presiding officer, on Christmas Day 1982, my dad collapsed with a cardiac arrest while out walking the dog near our home. A bus driver stopped to help him, but nothing could be done. Of course, I'll never know if a defibrillator would have saved him, but there is every chance it could have. That's why I'm passionate about defibrillators, expanding their use and getting them into as many communities as possible. All forms of public transport should carry them, and many already do. And they should be available in sports clubs, supermarkets, high streets, any public space where they could be needed urgently. And more importantly, let's get more defibrillators in areas of need, as I said earlier. This is absolutely vital. I completely agree with Jenny Minto's comment around planning regulations and new buildings for a defibrillator cabinet and to scrap the VAT. Surely that's not too much to ask. They're not expensive and are easy to maintain. They're also easy to operate, as I witnessed during a demonstration by St John's Ambulance in the village of Torrance in my constituency. St John's Ambulance and other charitable organisations help save lives across Scotland by providing advice, training and funding to communities wishing to install a public access defibrillator. They can also give vital training in CPR, which in conjunction with the use of a defibrillator will give sufferers the absolute best chance of survival. They can also work with you to establish the best location for a defibrillator in your local area, give advice on fundraising and help with the costs. Every minute without cardiopulmonary resuscitation and defibrillation reduces the chance of survival by up to 10%, which is why it's so important that there is quick access to defibrillators for the ambulance service. The registration on the circuit is absolutely essential. Presiding officer, as we've heard, there are around 135,000 people alive in Scotland today who've survived a heart attack. And while the survivor rates are generally high, there are around 3,200 out of hospital cardiac arrests in Scotland each year, and the survival rate in these cases is only 1 in 10. And currently less than 5% of out of hospital cardiac arrests receive bystander defibrillation. That number will increase with more availability of defibrillators and more people crucially having the confidence to use them. And I hope this debate will help in that regard. Remember, tens of thousands of defibrillators are currently not known by ambulance service. Knowing a defibrillator's location can literally be the difference between life and death for someone who suffered a cardiac arrest. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms Mackay, I now call on Marie Todd to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, I'd like to express my gratitude to the member, Jenny Minto, for bringing forward this motion today. She made it speech, as we have grown to expect from Ms Minto in this chamber, and used her own personal experience to make a powerful point that we can all learn from. And I'm very, very grateful to her. And I think it's a brilliant tribute to Carl to raise his story in this chamber so that we can all learn from it. It gives us an opportunity to raise awareness more generally about the importance of defibrillator usage and registration. I want to commend the work of the British Heart Foundation on this issue and the Scottish Ambulance Service and other partners who are involved in developing the circuit. It's an important tool to support our aims of ensuring that defibrillators are as accessible as possible in times of need. Continuing that sentiment, I also extend my thanks to the many other organisations and individuals who have taken and continue to take action to improve the survival from cardiac arrest in Scotland. That includes those who deliver CPR training, anyone who takes up that training, and that's more than 640,000 people across Scotland since 2015, people who raise funds for the placement of a defibrillator in their community, the emergency services who respond to instances of out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, and of course, to anyone out there who has ever stepped in to help when witnessing someone experience a cardiac arrest. I also want to take this opportunity to congratulate the Heart Start group in Ms Minto's constituency of Argyll and Bute. They recently won a Scottish Health Award for their commitment to delivering CPR training in schools, workplaces and community settings. Since Save a Life Scotland, of which Scottish Government is a key member, published its first strategy in 2015, we've seen a significant increase in the number of people surviving a cardiac arrest. In 2015, around 1 in 20 people survived. Now 1 in 10 do. That is incredible progress, of which we should be extremely proud. But we know we can do more to save lives, and that's why the Save a Life for Scotland partnership refreshed its strategy this year, and the partners have now set the aim of further increasing survival to 15% by 2026. So from 5% to 10%, and now we're aiming for 15%. I want to draw the members' attention to two very important points about this strategy. The first is its focus on addressing inequalities, and a number of members raised that issue. The second is its focus on the importance of increasing defibrillation rates. While we rightly celebrate the improvements in survival since 2015, we are acutely aware that some people are less likely to survive than others. We know that people living in more economically deprived areas face substantial inequalities. They're more likely to have a cardiac arrest, and when they do, they are less likely to survive than people who live in less deprived areas. We know also that people living in rural areas are less likely to survive than those who live in urban areas, and we want to tackle these inequalities. That's why the refreshed strategy embeds a focus on working collaboratively with these communities, delivering targeted work around our awareness and training. And as highlighted throughout this debate, the role that prompt defibrillation plays in the chain of survival is absolutely key. As part of the overall aim to increase survival, the refreshed strategy seeks to increase the number of out-of-hospital cardiac arrests which have a defibrillator applied before the ambulance service arrives, from 8 to 20%. Firstly, we're going to improve bystander confidence in them, using them. Save a Life for Scotland already are working to achieve this through better embedding defibrillator usage into awareness-raising campaigns and CPR training across Scotland. We also need to make sure that defibrillators are optimally placed and that they are accessible as accessible as possible. On the issue that Mr. Lumsden raised, which was around the access codes for defibrillator cabinets, we would thoroughly recommend that defibrillator guardians follow the advice of the Resuscitation Council of the UK and consider placing their defibrillators in an unlocked cabinet to make them as accessible as possible. And the RCUK highlights that despite widespread use of unlocked cabinets, instances of theft and vandalism are thankfully relatively uncommon. Let me outline how the registration of defibrillators is crucial. Firstly, in an incident of cardiac arrest, it's important that the Scottish Ambulance Service call handler can quickly identify if there's a defibrillator nearby and then direct a bystander to collect it. Then they can talk them through applying it. This is only possible if the defibrillator is registered and therefore visible to the call handler. That is reason number one to register a defibrillator. It increases the likelihood that it will be used if a cardiac arrest occurs nearby. The second reason is that the registration of defibrillators will enable us to have an overview of the defibrillator footprint right across Scotland. We know there are many defibrillators out there, but we could be better, and many of us have raised this, we could be better at making sure they are placed in the areas where cardiac arrests are most likely to occur. That brings me back to the importance of addressing inequalities. We know that most incidences of cardiac arrest occur in areas that are less likely to have extensive defibrillator coverage. The registration of defibrillators of all of the defibrillators in Scotland would provide a wealth of evidence to support people and organisations in making informed decisions about where to place their life-saving device. This would help to ensure that their generous actions would be most likely to have the impact that they had intended. So rather than pursuing legislative routes in terms of mandating where defibrillators go, for example, in new buildings, we are really keen to continue the collaborative and partnership approach to improving outcomes from cardiac arrest, which has been so successful to date. And we are, however, though, in terms of building regulations, we are, however, carrying out a review of permitted development rights at the moment. The PDR grant planning permission for gives planning permission for forms of developing, removing the need to apply for such permission. And as part of that review, we've committed to consider the case for introducing new or extended PDR for a wide range of development types, including defibrillator cabinets. So at the moment, you do have to apply for planning permission to place a defibrillator in an external area of a building, and we are consulting on whether that requirement should be removed. That consultation has been affected by the pandemic, but it remains part of our work plan, and it will be published in due course. On the issue of VAT, I am more than happy to write to the UK government on this issue. I know from an answer given to a question in Westminster recently that there is already a VAT relief scheme for the purchase of automated external defibrillators, AEDs, and that covers local authority purchase, eligible charities and the NHS. But they do state in that answer that they keep taxes under review, and far be it for me to defend them, there is a scheme there. I will absolutely lend my weight to anyone else in this chamber who wants to write and see if we can get that scheme extended to all purchases. So, to close, we've seen significant progress in survival from cardiac arrest over the last 5 years. It is a testament to many individuals and organisations, and a reminder, actually, as we've heard this evening, of many tragedies that have led people to campaign. I thank them for their work to date. I look forward to working together to continue progress. I also want to reiterate my thanks to the British Heart Foundation, the Scottish Ambulance Service and other partners for the development of the circuit. And finally, I want to offer my thanks to every defibrillator guardian in Scotland. Your actions play a vital part in helping to save lives from cardiac arrests. I'll finish today by asking of them, have you registered yours yet? Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament. Point of order, Jackie Dunbar.
My apologies, Presiding Officer. I was so excited that we had cross-party support at Aberdeen City Council that I forgot to refer members to my register of interest that I'm still a serving councillor at Aberdeen City Council.
Thank you, Ms Dunbar. That is on the record, and on that consensual note, I close this meeting of Parliament.